The best part about being a comedy team is that we get to split the money.
It's the best!
Why would we ever give that up?
That's so fun.
You mean they don't pay you double?
No!
What a Joke with Papa and Fortune on Netflix Is a Joke Radio.
Welcome back, everybody, to What a Joke with Papa and Fortune. I'm Tom Papa.
I'm Fortune Feinster.
And we're very excited because two of our very good friends are here. The Sklar Brothers.
Guys.
Randy and Jason, come on.
It's really just one and a half, really, when you boil us down.
Brad Williams is here. I love Brad Williams.
I just saw you guys in Montreal at JFL do awesome
on the roast battle.
So the crazy thing about that is that a year ago, Jeff was like, I want you guys to participate in the roast battle on Comedy Central. We're like, Jeff, you do understand that we do not, like, we've built a 25-year career of stand-up trying to help each other build something that's larger than the two of us. We're like Voltron, but funny.
Hopefully
funny. It's not for me to determine. But
Voltron's funny.
Voltron is, that dude go off.
Bro, he's funny, bro.
He was like, when Voltron was like, women be turning into cars and then shopping. So that's what we did. And we're like, Jeff, you want us to like go at each other? He's like, yeah, it should hurt just a little bit.
So we were like, okay, Jesus Christ.
How much are you going to pay us for this?
Like $2,500. We're like, each? He's like, yeah. We were like, all right, I'll do that. So we roasted each other. I mean, like, great. We roasted each other. Yeah, we roasted each other on Comedy Central. Jokes like,
Randy's a Jew.
Is that it?
No, that's okay. Randy's a Jew. His wife is a Jew. And yet, for some reason, they have a Christmas tree in their house.
That's true.
Every year, which I think is funny. And I remember the first year he had it, he called me and he said, where should I put this tree in my house? And I said, put it under the photo of our grandparents who hid during the Holocaust.
Okay. Hang on a second. Hold on a minute.
Do what Hitler couldn't do. Phase out Judaism.
All right. Oh,
and I know you were just following
me. I was.
Anyway,
so, I guess Jason and I still celebrate our birthday together, you know, just to give the illusion that Jason has friends too.
Hey, right, so, come on.
So what he did was, Jeff said, the reason I tell this whole story is that Jeff was like, I want you guys to do this. I really feel like you can do it.
And we in our hearts didn't think we could.
And we judge the roast battle. We judge it a lot in the belly room, like once a month. And so we understand it and love it and are a part of the show.
Yeah. I think we've judged it with you once or something.
You were with us one night when we judged together. But maybe. Have you judged it?
I have judged it.
So like, so we just were like, I don't know if we can do it against you.
Yeah.
He said, I want you to do it. And so we stepped outside of what is our comfort zone that we created, and it was great.
Yeah.
And now we take that roast and added some different jokes, and we put it in our act. It's now in this new hour. Yeah. So here we are building, and then we just rip each other apart.
That's great.
But that's always the best thing, and we had to trust Jeff because we've known him for 25 years. Yeah. We had to trust him that he did have a vision for what's right.
The great Jeff Ross.
And so about a month before Montreal, we see him outside the Comedy Store and he's like, I want you guys to roast somebody. He said at the beginning, it's not going to be like a tournament. It's just going to be, there'll be like specialty battles and maybe we'll get you guys roasting the Lucas Brothers. We're like, we like those guys. I don't know if we want to roast those guys. And so we said, we'll think about it. But again, we were posturing in the same way that we did initially. And we kept talking about it. And we thought maybe we should do it. And then we said, we'll judge. Maybe you can let us judge the roast battle. So 2 days before the Montreal, I think Blake Griffin maybe was going to roast Brad Williams, which would have been amazing.
Right, that's true.
And then
he didn't.
Yeah. He kind of dropped out and they're like, we need someone to roast Brad Williams. We're like, okay. I mean, I don't know if we love Brad.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
but there's definitely material.
Brad's wife is half Asian and Brad is half. What happened was we were able to then judge the undercard of the, because they didn't want us judging the finals, but we judged the undercards of those other shows.
Oh, that's cool.
Which were a blast. So here we were at this event that was, you know, every night at midnight at Montreal, and it was just this like electric, 1,100 people, all the people, you know, all the, you know, the industry people are up top and you're just like, okay, now we're at the very heart and the center of this show, which we weren't even really going to do.
It's amazing.
But you come back to the bar and that's what everyone's talking about.
Yeah.
So for us, it made that festival for us the best Montreal that we've had. And we've been there like a handful of times.
Yeah,
so
of course.
That was
the most fun. Well, it's kind of interesting. It's like, you think that it's just purely about being evil to be able to roast, but yeah. it really is about being great writers.
And love.
100%. That's the big thing.
And if you love someone right. and you or respect someone and love them, there yeah. is like, you can tell how much joy you took in writing that yeah. joke and yeah. doing that yeah. joke.
And you guys are, honestly, I was saying it before you came in, that you just keep getting stronger. You just keep getting better as comedians. You're very good writers. And it just, there's a depth to your stuff now that, you know, naturally because you've been doing it longer, but also because you've gotten better at writing and performing, you just, there's a depth to your stuff. Then I told you,
thank you.
They came on Live From Here, the NPR show.
So fun.
And I couldn't be there. I was driving, I was doing it remotely. Mm-hmm. And just to hear it on the radio so much cooler than seeing it live.
It
because
felt
when
like
you're
an
live, you
radio
see your
show.
Friend and you yeah. see your friends, they're doing
yeah.
a spot. And,
yeah.
But to hear it and just isolated, it isolates the material.
Yeah. Right.
It was so, I
texted
you guys right after and I couldn't, it was like one of those, when you're so excited, you just keep texting and texting like a crazy person. But
while
it really,
driving
it
and everything.
It yeah, really, really good. Hit me like that.
Well, I mean, both of you guys get it, and we love both of your stand-up acts, and so hey. It's the deeper you get, you hope that your next hour is your best,
right?
That
right.
we aren't past our best material, and so as yeah. we are sort of angling for this hour, which we're almost complete with,
yeah,
this is our favorite hour that we've done.
That's great,
and mm-hmm. so that's the way it should always be. But it's interesting as we start to, I still think we have stuff to figure out.
Yeah,
people
of course.
Are like, would you ever go on your own? Like, if what I do stand up, and then would yeah. Jay do
I'm
stand
like,
up?
No, the best part about being a comedy team is that we get to split the money.
It's the best. Why would we ever give that up?
That's so fun.
You mean they don't pay you double?
No.
I mean, no, but they. But there is. We do feel like there's more to learn. Like we've watched you guys evolve through the years, and it's like you learned how to be funny, and
right.
then you turn that funny onto deeper.
The
more,
best is
yeah.
when it can get broad. It gets broader in terms of who it connects with, but more specific from your life.
Right.
At the same time,
right.
It's like a director doing a rack focus.
Yeah. Yeah,
you're
yeah.
like coming into focus, but you're pulling away, and more people.
We
are able
saw
to.
You perform at the Comedy Store. The Comedy Store has like completely changed. I feel like the Comedy mm-hmm. Store and the Improv, and we love yeah. performing all. And we just performed at the Laugh Factory. Two nights ago,
yeah.
and I was like, I love this place.
Right.
Yeah.
I love this
forget.
Room. You forget yes. like how Adam Ray, our buddy, had a show and we went on the show. And
right.
I mean, it was, you know. It was,
it's fun when that place is jamming.
But I think the scene in LA has gotten a lot better.
Yes.
Don't you think?
Yes. But the Comedy yeah. Store is like, the Comedy Store used to in 99 when we came out here, it was kind of
spooky.
Yeah. Spooky and weird yeah. and there'd be five people in the crowd.
And, yeah, it was empty.
Empty. Mm-hmm. But that afforded you a little chance to just kind of let it fly and
yeah.
you don't
yeah.
care. Let's put up this thing that we've never set on stage before, or this thing that's
right.
at 40%. Let's figure
yeah.
it out.
Yeah, right.
But now
it
you really,
a gymnasium.
You can't do that. So I always love when I see comedians who I've been, you know, who are watching try something new in the OR when it's packed.
Yeah. yeah.
So I saw it was right as it was turning, Adam Egget like came in and
yeah.
just sort of
yeah.
like really in the, over the course of a long time. But right as it was turning, it was like completely packed. The audience was a little unruly. I actually think the audiences now understand how to go to that place and watch
right.
comedy.
Right, right.
And you had to come up there. I forgot the circumstances, whatever. And I'm like, all right. Because you want to get in the room and watch how Papa's going to handle
yeah.
this thing.
Also because you're not going to go like dirty or blue
no,
just to
right.
like,
you,
fire them into.
You,
no.
What you did that was awesome, and talk about deepening material. You relied on your stuff. And it was so funny because I was watching you and you're like, I'm going to get these guys and I'm going to get them on board. And by the end of my second or third bit, they're going to be 100% on board. And we watched it and I was like, wow. That
it was like a wave.
Oh, nice.
It was like a wave going over the
so
crowd.
Cool.
It was
oh,
awesome.
That's great.
It was awesome.
Just spanking
I was terrified.
Wait, hang on a second. That's a different show.
That is not a room you ever really get comfortable in.
Uh-uh.
Like you can get used to it, but
yep.
you're never, which is good. As a performer, to not be always
no. Well, I think part of the reason why that Randy and I we try to analyze this all the time.
Yeah.
I think part of it is so you get in that room and let's say you follow
Neil Brennan, and then Sebastian, and then you follow Chris D'Elia, and you follow like people who fill Madison Square Garden, and who no one should have, Joey Diaz. You follow people who no one should ever have to follow, and then there's no host, so there's no like interim thing that can kind of wipe the slate clean and they get them ready for you.
Yeah,
and so it's just a scenario that never ever happens. Like when you when you go on the road, there's a good host. When we all go on the road, there's a good host. There's a solid feature that's ramping up the crowd, and then they're there to see you.
Yeah.
And we developed this bit that just is perfect for us in that it I mean,
reboots
we can explain
them.
It. Yeah.
Well, it's an alt. It's sort of a it's alt because it's that's where our sort of roots are. But it's a play on that notion of just trying to find out who's in the crowd.
Uh-huh.
So it's a lot of like interaction with the crowd that it just completely gets.
So we're just like, where are my dudes at?
Dude,
and they make some noise. And they're like, okay, where are my ladies at? And they make
always because they're second always make more noise.
And we're like, dude, you just got me too. Like,
how you like
I don't know how that happened.
How you like that?
Okay, all right. Where are my single moms at?
Single moms.
And no one says it, and we're like, okay,
all right, good. And then we get into some hole. I'm like, where are my bros at?
Bros.
Where are my bros? And some guy's like, yeah. And I'm like,
all right. Are they different from dudes?
They're different from dudes.
Different.
So then Jay goes into this weird thing.
I'm like, where are my bros? Okay, where are my bros who recently went on a camping trip with their best bro? It got cold outside. So you guys climbed in the same sleeping bag
for warmth.
I mean, it really
warmth.
Was just for
warmth.
But then you looked into his eyes.
Oh.
And for one second, you're like, I'd let him put the tip in.
Where are you at?
Where are you
at? Glad to have you here. Okay, where? And then we go back to the ladies. Ladies, we're back to you. Hey, where are ladies? All right, where are my ladies out there who support the war but not the troops? Where? Seriously, where are you? You got to get out of here.
Very specific.
It's so specific.
That is the wrong attitude for this war.
And once we're done with that, they're like, who was on stage right before? And then it just completely erases, and then you go right into it.
It's like high energy, but it's a twist on a thing.
Yeah.
And it has levels, and we're writing more in it, and it's growing.
Right.
Can Tom and I start doing that at the Comedy Store?
Yes, you may.
Please.
Okay. Yes, you may.
Helpful.
Where are you at?
I see Fortune on stage going, where are you at?
Where are my dudes at?
Bros,
who went, I messed it up. Who went camping? Campers? Who likes camping?
Where am I putting my tip? Where am I putting my tip?
Are we just doing the tip? Is that what's happening right now?
I can't calculate this tip.
Thanks for watching What a Joke.
Make sure to comment, like, subscribe.
Tell us what guests you'd like us to have on.
Yeah, you tell us.
Do something.